Today we are going to discuss about the
गुड मॉर्निंग सर।
गुड मॉर्निंग विश्वजीत। टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस अबाउट द आर्ट एंड आर्किटेक्चरल डेवलपमेंट ड्यूरिंग द पीरियड ऑफ पेशवा। लेट मी शेयर द कंटेंट। ओके, सो लेट अस स्टार्ट विथ डिस्कसिंग अबाउट द टाउन प्लानिंग। You know, as during the Peshwa's period, there was an urbanization of the cities like Pune, Solapur, and Satara. So the town planning also involved in the art and architectural. The town, they mainly develop as a political or pilgrimage center or business center. And generally, if you look at the urbanized spaces of those period, the growth of the town, it was not, it did not have a master plan like we generally have nowadays. It was a kind of haphazard growth. As the city went on growing, different fates were established. And nevertheless, though the growth was haphazard, the ruler Peshwas, they tried to beautify the cities. They took care that cities are protected by the protective wall, water supply system is there, social segregation is there, you know. Caste-wise, people used to stay into different area. They took adequate precaution that health and sanitation facilities are provided. With new immigration, new areas begin develop like Raviwar Pet and Sadashiv Pet in Pune. You know, generally the name of that new area Pet was given on the name of a particular day, that is Raviwar Sunday, or a name of a particular person who has taken a lot of effort in establishing that area, or who had been, you know, popular, or who was among the ruling nobility, like Sadashiv Pet. And the city generally, they had a protective wall. The road within the city used to be very, very small road, like, you know, one bullock cart could only pass through that. And it was probably deliberately kept small so that in case of invasion, it becomes difficult for the enemy to move swiftly through that small road. And in any case, during those days, there were no very heavy vehicle, very heavy vehicle as such. So only one bullock cart can pass, only that much road was generally being kept in the cities developed during the Peshwas period. The houses were generally very close to each other. Again, it served one more purpose of protection. Like if the houses are close, it becomes difficult for the invading army to move in the city. For water supply, there used to be generally lake in the city, and sometimes through canal the water is brought from the lake outside the city or from the dam. Affluent people who used to live in the big mansion kind of houses, they used to generally have a small pond in their house. Pet, many times they develop according to the caste and profession. People belonging to the particular profession used to live into the particular area. There was a system of drainage in the cities like Pune, and the roads were usually stone paved. You know, it was not a concrete, use of concrete was not extensively prevalent during those days, but it was stone paved road so that it can be used during the rainy season as well. There is a reference to the repairing of the road done after the rainy season. This is already done well. There are certain references to the wooden bridges, but of course the construction, the technology of the construction of the bridges were not very well developed. We do get certain references and certain evidences that the wooden bridges were constructed, but they were not many in number. Mostly it is the boats which were used to cross the rivers. There are references that Chhatrapati Shahu has constructed a bridge across Nira River on the request of Brahmendra Swami, and Nana Sahib Peshwa has constructed a wooden bridge in Pune. And Nana Sahib Peshwa also took effort to beautify the road. For example, the road from Pune to Pashan, and then Pune to Katraj, and then Pune to Thevur, and Pune to Alandi. All those important roads, Nana Sahib Peshwa took the effort that by the side of these roads, the trees are planted, and the local people were given responsibility to look after the plants. If we need to talk about houses, mansion, and palaces, we find that the palaces, big houses that were constructed during those days, they were mostly of wooden. Extensive use of wood was used, and you know, the wooden building, it cannot endure for a very long period. It need a regular maintenance, like, you know, you have to apply oil and all, otherwise it gets spoiled. And later on, as Peshwa's financial condition deteriorated and Peshwa became extinct, all those mansion were extensively wood was used has deteriorated, as well as certain, you know, that those mansion which were called wada in Marathi. You know, they were washed away. Many of them were washed away in the river flood, and many of them, you know, with the time, they just withered away. Some of them have burned also. So we don't get a lot of architectural heritage of Peshwa's period, because for the simple reason that most of the dwelling houses were constructed of wood, and during the course of time, they are lost to us. Well, nevertheless, whatever the wada, you know, the wada used to be the big house of the very affluent person. And whatever the wadas are left, important wadas there are certain important wada. And one of the important good example of the wada kind of architecture is Deshpande wada at Shivapur. Remember this kind of small things, you know, because you are going to face MCQ kind of exam. So usually these kind of questions might be asked. Where is Deshpande Wada, you know, or what was Wada? And this Deshpande Wada was constructed at the end of 18th century, which is having two stories, 150 long and 150 broad. And it did not have gallery. You know, the Wada structure did not generally had gallery. And it's very having a central hall, having a wooden pillar, very thick walls. And windows were very less windows. The thick wall generally, you know, kept wada cool because it was made up of mud. And the ceiling is of kavelu type, roof tiles. You know, this is a modern kind of replica of those old kavelu system. But you could have seen this kind of houses in the villages in the rural area. They still use this kind of kavelu. The typical arrangement of wada is the plinth is constructed of generally stone, brick, and lime. Of course, the walls were also constructed by this, you know, brick and lime. But there is an extensive use of wood inside those walls, as well as outside decoration like pillars and all. It were made of wood. So generally, wada generally had a very high plinth of 10 to 15 feet. And the wall used to be quite thick, minimum 3 feet thick, and it gives protection and cooling effect as well. Generally, the wada will have, once you enter into the wada, you will enter into the central hall, and that central hall will be surrounded by the room. And in the veranda, you know, central hall, then veranda, and then room. So the area that is connecting the rooms and central hall is generally called as veranda. And generally in that veranda, the master of, you know, usually these kind of wadas are of affluent people who were generally used to have a lot of land and collecting of the taxes, all those responsibility. So, you know, usually that person, the owner of that house, will have his office in the veranda, which is called fud. If you remember, fud was also word used for the place where the official used to sit in the Shaniwar Wada, that is the place where Peshwa used to stay. So that was called fud. So fud is a place of sitting of the clerk. So it is office only. So veranda generally it serve as office. And then apart from that, there were different rooms, like, you know, there was Devghar Puja, where the, you know, the gods are being worshipped. Then office of the owner of the wada, you know, he will have his independent room as an office where he can go and transact the business. Other rooms were generally used for the personal use of his family member. And the wadas, obviously, all the wadas were not very same standard. The very affluent person can have a bigger wada, having more number of room. And this very affluent person's wada usually had Diwan Khana. Diwan Khana used to be the big room on the ground floor where he will go deliver justice. You know, during those days, we have seen the administrative structure, the revenue collection and the delivery of justice. Generally, it is combined together. So he will deliver the justice and he transit other government work. It was a kind of meeting place, Diwan Khana, separate arrangement. And, you know, in Diwan Khana, generally, sometimes the affluent ladies also sat in that Diwan Khana during the transition of the business, during the delivery of the justice. So the partition was made, you know, it was made of wood, the carved wood, design wood. And behind that wooden partition, generally the ladies of that affluent family used to sit. So it will have the decorated wooden pillars, which could be, you know, it will also have decorated wooden pillar. It could be of square size or it could be a rounded size made by the carpenter, you know. And this separation, wooden separation, later on it became a symbol of being royalty and affluent. Anybody who wants to show off his affluence We'll have this wooden kind of carved wood and the wooden kind of net in the Diwan Khana or in the front room, and that is used to divide the room into the two parts. Now also it is used. Half of the room, if you want to partition, you can just put a wooden net kind of design, and half of the portion can be used as a dining space, and half of the portion can be used as a drawing room. Then apart from this Diwan Khana, many times these affluent people also have Darbar Hall. Of course, it will be in the house of the very affluent people, and here assembly generally held if you want to have a meeting. Then these affluent people also had Arse Mahal, that is a hall of a mirror, and usually this is on the first floor, and this is, for the entertainment purpose, where people will go and check themselves, how do they look. Then Rangamahal used to be the part of the Wada. Rangamahal was colored hall where all kind of pictures of the ancestors, artifact brought from the different places will be kept for the people to show. Then Asmani Mahal used to be the place or the room which is at the highest place, and this is generally the husband and wife, they can go and spend time there in the evening in privacy, as well as this Asmani Mahal is also used by the owner of the house to keep a watch over the surrounding area, because from Asmani Mahal being at the highest point, you can look at a further distance. Then ceiling of the house were usually of dhaba type or kavelu type. Kavelu I have shown how the tilted tiles, and dhaba is generally, you put the wooden planks, and on that wooden plank you plaster it with the mortar and mud, and on the top of it you put tins, so that becomes dhaba, so that keeps the house cool. Generally, the bracket, some of the houses also had bracket. Bracket used to be the kind of protruding portion that comes out from the wall, and that is generally used to hang something, or it is also used for the decorative purpose. The windows, there was a very less use of iron. The windows generally they were made up of wooden only, you including the separation that we use of generally iron now. Jhumbar used for decoration, that was also generally made up of wooden, because the glass manufacturing industry did not develop that much. The jhumbar and glass are generally imported, and that is very costly. Everybody obviously could not have a glass jhumbar in their house, so it was made up of wooden also. Knitted decorated wooden separation, as I told you earlier, that was generally used to separate women, to create a separate place for the woman to sit in Diwan Khana or Darbar Hall, and it began to be considered as a mark of affluence. And wall paintings are generally used to decorate the Diwan Khana. And obviously, all the wadas did not definitely had all these things: Arse Mahal, Rangamahal, Diwan Khana. Whoever was affluent, generally they will be having more bigger wada and bigger room and more different kind of room. Now let us talk about the garden and fountain. The Maratha wadas, which were constructed earlier, obviously garden and fountain was not part of it. But as the empire have extended in the north, these fountains are generally found in the Mughal architecture, and that is later on copied by the Marathas. So we find a fountain in the Shaniwar Wada and Wada of Moroba Dada in Pune. Remember this kind of small things, like where is the Wada of Moroba Dada? All right. And in the Shaniwar Wada, there is a fountain in the center called Pushkarni. Pushkarni Fountain or Pushkarni Lake is in Shaniwar Wada. It was Nana Saheb who was having he's believed to be a Peshwa, having an aesthetic sense. So he was a person who constructed a Wada at Hirabagh, and that is the first Wada constructed under Peshwa with Wada and garden. Now let us talk about water supply. Generally, the vale and lakes, which is called Houd in Marathi, they were generally having in the cities to cater for the requirement of the water. For example, in Pune we have Sadashiv Houd, Pushkarni Houd is in Shaniwar Wada itself, then Natu Houd, Kala Houd, Bahuli Houd, and in Satara there is a Mangalwar Tale. Tale is also a word used for the lake in Marathi. For example, this is a photo of Mangalwar Lake at Satara. This is constructed during those days, during Peshwa's period. It's obviously not very well maintained. To supply water to Pune city, in 1750, Nana Saheb Peshwa, he constructed dam at Katraj. So this is a dam, and the lake that is formed by the dam is known as Nana Saheb Peshwa Lake. And through this lake, the water was provided through channels to Shniwarwada and Pune city. Apart from that, during this period, Nagpur city, though it was ruled by Bhosle, but it was under Peshwa's, during those period, Peshwa's time, a number of lakes were also constructed in Nagpur, like Shukravari Talav we have, then Ambazari Talav and Telankhedi Talav. You know what is the Telankhedi Talav is also called? What is Telankhedi Lake is called in Nagpur? Yes, anybody?
So is it
Kutala.
Kutala?
Yes.
Kutala?
Yes. Telankhedi Lake is generally, popularly, we call it Futaala Lake. We know it is known as Futaala Lake. So these were the lake constructed by the Bhosle ruler during Peshwa's time. Now let us go to the military architecture. See, the big official, they used to stay in a place called Gadi. So Gadi was a kind of small castle. You understand the difference between fort and castle? Castle is something which is constructed on the plain land and having a protective wall so that the soldiers can stay inside and fight. Fort is constructed on the mountain, on the hills. So, well, it was built, not built. Well, so this small kind of castle, they are generally built by zamindar at different places on the plain land, and this gadi it serves as a place of resident as well as conducting an administration. That local administrator has to conduct the administration from that gadi. In fact, Shaniwarwada, which was a place of residence for Peshwa, was also a gadi. It was constructed on the plain land. Of course, it became very big, so generally it is a castle, but nevertheless, it did not had a kind of protective wall. Chhatrapati has prevented Peshwa from constructing the protective wall, thinking that the Peshwa might become independent. So it is also a kind of gadi, but it's very big, no doubt about it. And gadi is usually a square shape, having a protective wall of stone and brick, usually 20 foot. The wall used to be quite high, 20 foot high and 5 to 7 feet broad. And important gadis still are surviving. That is Jadhavwadi is a place, and Saswat. These are the two places where we find the gadis of Peshwa's period. And entrance of that gadi, generally, this is a, I'm showing you Shaniwarwada, but this is a typical example of the gadi architecture. The entrance will be as high as elephant mounted by a man can usually pass through. So, and here there used to be guard, and here you see there is an opening here. So, this is done to protect this entrance. From here, the guard can fire at a person if somebody is trying to enter the gadi. This is the opening, and usually this gadi will be having a water supply, either or it will have big well or there will be canal, and the wooden door will be having a very big nails. You can see here big nails on the both the side of entrance, and once we enter here inside, there will be rooms for the sentries, the guard, they can for the protection of this entrance. There is some word called for this opening. I am forgetting that. Let me just recollect. Jangi. This is called Jangi. The opening in this wall. See, here is the opening. Here is the opening. And from here, the guard can fire at somebody who is trying to enter into the gadi. And this is called Jangi. For the firing of, it could be small cannon, firing of the gun, firing of the arrows as well. Generally, there will be protective walls around the cities and towns. Entrance will be protected by guards. Top opening, Jangi, I told you. Well. Fort, of course, the fort, generally during Peshwa's period, the importance of fort has gone down. But nevertheless, fort also had all these kind of thing that is usually in the gadi, that is a wall and entrance and jangi that is opening for firing. It will have water supply. Otherwise, there will be a lake on the fort so that the water, which water can be stored during the monsoon and can be utilized during the latter period. There will be places of residence, offices. Now let us go to the religious architecture. During Peshwa's period, temples, samadhi, chhatri, dharmashala, ghat, and kund. These are the different kind of religious architecture. Now what it is, we will discuss one by one. Temple, everybody know what temple is, where the god is worshipped. Many temples of Yadavas period, they got prepared during Peshwas period. For example, temple of Kasba Ganpati in Pune, temple of Khandoba at Pali and Jejuri. And Brahmendra Swami, the very important, very influential person during Peshwas period, he constructed Parshuram temple at Chiplun and Dwadashi. He also constructed Ganpati temple at Rajuri. See, this is the temple of Parshurama constructed by Brahmendra Swami at Chipulun. Chipulun is in Konkan region. Well, then in 1730, Ranoji Shinde, he constructed Kedareshwar temple at Jyotiba Hills. Nana Saheb Peshwa, he constructed temple of Deva Deveshwara at Parvati in Pune. At Nashik, he also constructed Trimbakeshwara temple. And during this period, many temples were constructed at Nashik, Pandharpur, Wai, Mahuli, Jejuri, Pali. And Peshwa, he generally constructed temples in around Pune, of course, at Nashik also, Trimbakeshwara temple. Shinde and Holkar, generally, they constructed temples at Jejuri. And Ahillabai Holkar, the head of the Holkar family after Mallara Holkar, she was a very devoted person, religious kind of person. And she constructed temple at different places like Varanasi in the north and then Rameshwar in the south, Nashik in Maharashtra, Maheshwar is near Indore, and Pandharpur in Maharashtra. Purandare, one of the Maratha Sardar, he constructed temples at Saswad, and the temples are generally known as Sangvateshwar, Sangameshwar temple. Then Patavardhan, they constructed temples at Sangli and Tasgao. Nana Fadanvis, a very important person during Peshwa's period, he constructed Bhimashankar temple at the origin of Bhima river. And Hingne was the representative of Marathas in the court of Delhi. Remember this. And this, though these people, they remain in north for a very long period. For example, Shinde and Holkar and Hingne and Bundele for their political assignment, for their administrative assignment, they kept contact with their native places and usually constructed temples or their samadhi of their ancestor at their native places in Maharashtra. So Hingne, though he stayed in Delhi for a very long period, one after another, he constructed Nilkantheshwar temple at Nashik, and then Vateshwar temple at Saswad was also constructed during Peshwa's period. Peshwa's period, Nashik has also flourished a lot in the construction activities of temple. For example, Rameshwar temple was constructed in 1747, Trimbakeshwar 1750, Sundara Narayan temple 1756 and Kalaram temple 1782. At Toke in Ahmednagar district, Siddheshwar temple was constructed in 1760 during Peshwa's period. At Nevase, Mohini Raj temple was constructed, and it took a lot of time, almost 10 years, 1760 to 1770. And the temples that were generally constructed after 1760, usually the manison and the artisan, they were called from outside. And we generally find that on those temples, there is an influence of Nagari and Hindustani influence, because this artisan, they came from outside. Usually this temple will be have decorated wall. So this is Mohini Raja temple at Nevase, which took almost 10 years. So, it's made up of stone, and the carving of stone and putting it on the top of one another, it takes a lot of time. So you remember this kind of, this kind of questions will be asked in MCQ. Where is Mohini Raja temple? So you should be able to answer that it is at Nevase. This is, I'll be showing you some of the pictures of the temple so that it will become easy for you to remember. This is the Deva Deveshwara temple, which is at Parvati in Pune. Parvati is area, Parvati are name of the hills in Pune. This is the Trimbakeshwar temple in Nasik, very famous temple. Well, now this is the temple architecture. Now, apart from that, the ghats were constructed at the different river bank. The purpose of ghat, it used to be kind of pavement kind of construction on the bank of the river. And on that ghat, generally, people used to perform their religious rituals like yagya or, shraddha ceremony. And going to take bath in the river was considered as a purifying action. And if you have a ghat, things become convenient. Otherwise, it will be all mud and all that. So for that religious purpose, the ghats are constructed. Ahillabai Holkar have constructed a lot many ghats. She constructed ghat at Banaras, Maheshwar, Pandharpur, Nashik, Rameshwar. And Peshwa also encouraged the Maratha Sardar to construct ghat at places like Nashik, Wai, and Pandharpur. So I'll show you the ghat. So this is the ghat in Nashik. So you see the pavement kind of thing where people can walk up to the water, avoiding any mud and all, and they can perform their religious rituals according to the Hindu tradition. Well, Chhatri is generally constructed in the memory of a dead person, and in Chhatri it will be a structure, temple kind of structure, and inside the temple there will be Shivalinga. You know the Hindus they worship Shivalinga very extensively. You will find large number of Shivalinga temple everywhere, all over the country. Chhatri, many times very beautiful architecture are constructed. For example, Indore, near Indore, there are places where we have Chhatris of Holkar family. And Ahillabai Holkar Chhatri, that is constructed after her death, is at place called Maheshwar. Maheshwar is close to Indore, around 50 kilometers from Indore. And then Vanavadi, as I told you many times, these Marathas, they went to north, but they kept in touch with their native place. Mahadaji Shinde, one of the very capable person of Shinde family, his Chhatri is constructed at Vanavadi. Vanavadi is near Pune. So this is a Chhatri of Mahadaji Shinde. Very good structure, one of the very good piece of architecture of Peshwa's period. So we see here, this is a hall having a two-story, and this is a main temple where inside there will be a Shivalinga. Well, about sculpture, sculptures were very not well developed. In generally speaking, art and architecture did not reach to the very high standard during Peshwa's period. Sculptures are generally of two type. The freestanding sculpture and the sculptures which are constructed, which are pressed to the wall, which are their back is pressed to the wall or to the rock. So freestanding structures are generally imported from outside, mainly from Rajasthan. Architectural these sculptures are generally on the temple shikhara, on the higher point of the temple. So this is called shikhara, and on the shikhara you find some sculptures that is constructed during the Peshwa's period. But they are not considered aesthetically speaking, or from the perspective of an expert, they are not of a very high standard. The faces of those sculptures are generally expressionless. They are not as lively as we find at Ajanta and Ellora, which was an achievement of much earlier period. During Peshwa's period, we don't find that kind of very standard and architecture of a very high level. Well, the Ahillyabai have constructed a lot of temples, and on her temples we find sculptures on the outside wall, and generally these sculptures are having Rajput and Gujarati influence, because those architects and those artisans were brought from those area. There is a Siddheshwar temple in the Tok, at Tok, that is in Ahmednagar district, and in that Siddheshwar temple there is a sculpture of two elephants fighting each with each other. So you remember this. These are the very few important architectural achievement, sculptural achievement of Peshwa's period. There is a sculpture of elephant at Chhatri of Holkar at Maheshwar in MP, and this is a proof that in northern India definitely the sculpture architecture was much better than what was happening in Maharashtra. Then there is a sculpture of swan at Mohiniraja temple in Nevase. This is also considered as one of the good example. Many times the theme of these sculptures are generally drawn from the epic like Ramayana and Mahabharata. But those characters are generally depicted as using the Marathi dresses. The women, we have already shown you the dresses of Marathi women, like lugda. They will be shown wearing that kind of dresses. Mohiniraja temple, again, it depict the sculpture where Peshwa Madhavrao, first Madhavrao, he's sitting with his courtier in his court. That sculpture is carved in the Mohiniraja temple at Nevase. Now, among the sculpture, there is one typical example of the sculpture type, and that is Virgal. Remember this. In Marathi, it is pronounced at Virgal, as in Hindi there is no L, so it can be pronounced as a Virgal. And this Virgal is a very very crude kind of structure. See, it's not very refined. Generally, one big stone will be taken, and on that, this kind of crude carving will be done. There will be a kind of statue, and there will be a hand generally. See, hands here also. And these are Virga is a sculpture which is carved in the memory of a brave person, a person who has died in the war or who has died in the protection of the cattle from the thews and the cage. And generally, in the memory of that brave person who gave his life in that act of bravery, this kind of Virga kind of sculpture is being carved. Painting, in case of painting, we get mention of that during the Peshwa Bajirao first time, there was a painter like Raghav, Tanaji, and Anup Rao. And under Madhav Rao first, there was a painter called Manpoji. And there was a system of decorating wada and temple with painting. And generally, the Dashavatar, there are 10 incarnation of Vishnu according to the Hindu tradition. So that theme is generally used for painting. Ganesha, Shiva, Parvati—these are the popular god among the Hindu. As well as Rama Panchayatani is very extensively used. Rama Panchayat means there will be Rama, Sita. These are the three brothers of Rama, Lakshmana, and then Shatrughna and Bharat. And there is a Hanumana, the devotee of Rama. So these are the five people, including Rama and Sita, and they are considered as a Rama Panchayatan. Generally, you will find this kind of painting everywhere in Maharashtra, almost in all the temples. And this was very extensively used during Peshwa's period. Of course, the women are being portrayed as wearing the Marathi kind of dresses. See here, Sita. Sita is wearing the Marathi style of lugda. North Indian ladies, they don't wear this kind of sari. The Navari sari that is worn by the Marathi lady. Well, there are some miniature paintings also where devotional poems are being portrayed with a small painting. And in case of painting, very important development has taken place during the last phase of Peshwai. That is during the period of Savai Madhavrao, along with British representative Millet. There was a painter called James Wells and Daniel, they both came to Pune. And James Wells, he stayed in Pune for a very long period, and he made some of the very beautiful painting of that period. He draw the painting of Savai Madhavrao and Nana Fadnis and Mahadaji Shinde. And under James Wells, a school of painting also started at Pune. And James Wells, he trained certain Maharashtrian people like Gangaram Tambat. He was a person who trained by James Wells. So there is a book written on James Wells by Uday Kulkarni, and this is a painting done by James Whale. You see here Savai Madhavrao and Nana Fadanis. These two might be attendant, but there is a book on the painting of James Wales. So this is all about the art and architectural development during Peshwa's period. So since beginning, we have seen that town planning was not that good, but nevertheless, arrangements were made to take the water to the people. The houses, the big affluent people, they had a wada kind of structure. And this wada are having different rooms like Diwan Khana, Arse Mahal, Ranga Mahal. Garden and fountain was not there in the beginning, but later on it was the Maharashtrian, they tried to incorporate it as they copied it from the north. The dams were constructed, like this is a Kathras dam constructed by Nana Saheb Peshwa. And large number of lakes were constructed during Peshwa's period, like we have this Telankhedi Lake in Nagpur and Pushkarni Lake in Pune and Mangalwari Talav in Satara. In case of military architecture, Gadhi became one of the important prominent architectural feature of Peshwa's period. Gadhi is generally constructed on the plain land as forts are on the hills, and it is a kind of small forts only, having all kind of protective wall. Entrance is protected by the room for the sentries, and there will be an opening to fire for like jangi, that is called jangi, to fire at the person who is invading the gadi. Then temple architecture has flourished a lot. Large number of temples were constructed at Nashik, Pune, Pandharpur. This is one of the temple which is constructed at Chipulun, Ramendra Swami has constructed this temple, Temple of Parshurama. Then Temple of Devadevadeshwar is constructed by Nana Sahib Peshwa. At Nashik, he constructed the Trimbakeshwar Temple. This is Temple of Mohini Raja Temple, which is constructed at Navasi during Peshwa's period. This is Devadevadeshwar Temple at Parvati. This is the Trimbakeshwar Temple at Nashik. And apart from other other form of religious architecture is construction of the ghat, so that the performance of the religious rituals become easier. Chhatri is constructed in the memory of the dead person, and this is a chhatri of Mahadaji Shinde at Vanwadi near Pune. Among the sculptures, of course, sculptures was not very, very well developed. There are a few examples like sculpture of swan in Mohini Raja Temple and the sculpture of two elephants fighting at Tok in district Ahmednagar. And then Virgal is a typical kind of sculpture. We don't find it at any other places. And this is a very crude kind of thing, small, constructed on a single, carved on a single stone. And in the memory of the brave person who died. And painting, generally the theme drawn from the Hindu scriptures are used, like Ram Panchayatan and Dashavatar. During the latter phase of Peshwa, that is during the period of Savai Madhavrao, James Wells came to Pune and he made some of the very beautiful painting. And one of the important painting of James Wells is the painting of Nana Fadnavis and Savai Madhavrao. So this is where I stop here today. In case if you have any doubt, you can ask me.